And this will be the opportunity for you to ask any follow-up questions you may have to our expert panelists. So without any further ado, may I invite the first question from the audience? Yeah, I've got a member of the audience from the very far back over there.
How the advancement affect teachers' professional development?
All right, so this question is about the possible effects of the technology advancements and teacher development.
So I think one of the serious problems is having the external resources, having the ability in classrooms to actually build in technology-based academic teaching or reading. And I don't know how it will happen except gradually over time as more and more resources move from print to digital media.
Excellent question. I would say that
technology is not part of the future, it's part of the present for our students, and we need to rethink what we do in our classrooms, and also for those of us who are teacher trainers, we need to really figure out how to address this in our teacher training classrooms, so that teachers, when they graduate from our teacher training programs, are more equipped to deal with technology in their classrooms in an effective way, because teachers are so busy. This is one more thing that teachers need some tools for.
I'll answer the question in a slightly different way, and then I think that technology allows enormous opportunities to create supportive communities between teachers. So in the work I'm working in Malaysia, working with teachers there, they've set up their own WhatsApp groups and Facebook, and of course just texting each other. And as they become more experienced teachers, their interactions become more and more professional. So I think that the affordances of technology to create supportive communities where we can share ideas and take up problems is something we really need to promote and exploit.
Yeah, I think Bill would like to add.
So I'd like to follow up on John's comment. You know, I'm a reading specialist, and I believe every opportunity to look at text, whether it's print or digital, is yet another experience, sorting through words, putting together meaning, and having that experience and exposure that's going to make you a better reader. Of course, one of the things that our resources include texts that are on digital media or places and for situations where there isn't a lot of text available in print. And so it is a major opportunity. The issue is, do teachers know where these texts are? Do teachers know how to use these texts? Do teachers know how to get students to be reading them and be accountable for the information in the text? And as students are accountable for information in the text, they move more and more in academic situations.
I too would like to add to what John said, and that specifically in cases in most parts of the world, these technological innovations that connect teachers in the rural areas with teachers in the urban areas really helps teachers in the rural areas stay caught up with trends and innovations in the field. So these types of online communities are really very valuable for everyone.
That's wonderful. Thank you very much, Francis, for your comprehensive answer. All right, do we have a second question from the audience? Yes, we got one from over there. Can we have the microphone, please?
Hi, I already have a microphone.
Wonderful.
So my question is about digital reading. So naturally, digital reading involves some sort of digital literacy. And I was wondering, since most of our students already have some sort of digital literacy when they enter our classrooms, do you think that just by simply encouraging them to read using their computers or their smartphones, that would somehow
romance reading romance novels. She talked about following her heroes on Instagram. She talked about Facebook. She was doing almost nothing academic and doing very little extended reading. Except for these free romance novels, which is wonderful. But I feel like, and I'm hoping we made the point in our plenary address, is that for more serious reading, digital reading does require someone. It's a continuation of reading, and all readers need to practice a lot. We can actually help students be more efficient with their digital reading by guiding them in the classroom with activities that are specific to the challenges that students face, especially all those distractions that we're faced when reading, whether it's on their cell phones or tablets or laptops.
I think the issue of getting them to look at digital texts and turn them loose is the same kind of challenge as having people read a lot of books without expecting any need for instruction or any kind of support resources. I think what we know from print reading is that instruction helps. It doesn't mean that you do instruction without reading, you have to read a lot. But instruction helps. So the same issue applies to digital. Just because there's a device in front of a student, and you say, here's where texts are, and you say, well, look at 10 texts this week, it is necessarily going to be the most effective way to work with the digital medium. There has to be some way to guide students, to help students work through what they're reading, keep records of what they're reading, engage in what they're reading, so they get motivated to read productively. And going to enjoy with your reading.
So, I think the digital world is wonderful, but for students, it's a bit like you, someone saying to you, okay, what's your favorite department store? Okay, you have 1 minute in your favorite department store to get everything, anything you want. And it's overwhelming. What do you choose? What do you decide? So, for me, I think that it's a really important role for the teachers to provide guidance as to what is appropriate. I think that when we think about using technology in the classroom, we have to ask some fundamental questions. Like, how is this helping students learn better than what I do currently? How is this a better use of time than the time I currently use for this activity? So we need to ask those fundamental questions before we introduce them to this world and then give them guidance so that they make the best use of it.
So I'll take a sort of a side trajectory on Tom's answer. You know, there are a lot of people in a lot of places where there aren't enough print resources, and the only option you can have are digital resources that might become available through your phone. Doesn't mean that they shouldn't have support, but the idea is it may not be as good as in class. And so the question would be, how do you devise digital supports for reading through digital media when you're trying to reach out to places where print media and good classroom support isn't available? And that's an interesting challenge.
Thank you very much for your answers. Now, we still have plenty of time and we can have a few more questions. And so, any other questions you might have? Yes. Can we have a microphone for our participants in the front there?
How do you find digital media and paper media to be different?
That was short and simple.
Digital reading is a continuation of regular reading, print reading, but it also has some distinctive features. And the distractions that we talked about, the hyperlinks, staying on track, students lose their goals for reading because they're just so easily distracted, and we can help them learn to stay on track. And also, you know, these issues of reliability that are really, really important. There's much more vetting that goes goes on with print text than there is with digital media.
I think you have to sort out types of material and types of resources that are available to you and the types of tasks you hope it executes. So, for example, I'm a fairly recent person coming to an online reader.
Right.
explaining your current teaching situation, I was thinking about how often writing teachers so often ask their students to write without connecting it to texts. And so often, at least in the academic world, our writing is inextricably linked to the reading that we've done. Students need to learn not only to summarize and to synthesize, so connecting reading to writing is so important for so many of our students, and we should actually guide them in the process. Whether it's print reading or digital reading, it's worth guiding them so that it's hard to synthesize. PhD students have trouble writing a literature review because rather than writing a paragraph about every article that they've read, they have to learn to synthesize it and pull things together. And it becomes a little more challenging when people are reading digitally because, at least for our generation, we used to have all of those articles laid out in front of us on the floor or on our desks. Now we need to find them with bookmarks on the web. And so there's a lot to consider to prepare students to read to write.
And I just add something that occurred to me as a previous talk. You know, we mustn't lose the sight of that reading, writing, connection. And I talked just about the activity cycle idea. And I think one of the problems we often find in writing courses is that people do not prepare students sufficiently so they understand what they're writing about. So you make this assumption that your students can't write what they're writing. And actually, the real problem is they're not understanding that rather on top you've got to write about, you can provide the input. So I think it's something I feel kind of strongly about, actually, you know, that people make judgments about people's writing and then mistaking it for the fact that they haven't actually done the reading beforehand.
All right, thank you very much, and we may have the time for one more question.
Well, versus, oh, here's a newspaper story. Okay, well, you know, it's not an academic article, but usually journalists try and verify their sources, and so you have a greater belief in the objectivity. But even print writing is biased sometimes.
Well, but I know I said we could have only one more question, but it seems that we still have some time left. Maybe one truly last question?
Hi, thank you for sharing your work today. Does it seem like the Google search engine results, is it a genre itself? Like, is it a type of reading text that you can, it seems like you're teaching it through a new approach like that. And I've never thought about teaching my students like that, so I really appreciate the idea. Is that kind of on the mark, or is that how you're approaching this? Or
you go to the library and go to the card catalog and we look for different books on a topic, or you know, later on we went to like library, not physical card catalogs, but a library list of sources and journals. Now Google serves a lot of the same purpose, that we look for information there, but many people aren't very conscientious or systematic in really deciding where to go when you have 700,000 results from putting in two keywords. So where do you begin? It probably is a new genre. It's a new written genre. It actually has characteristics with the title and the URL and the little blurb. But because so many of our students are now looking for information through Google search or other search engines, seems like they would benefit from learning to do this search in a more conscientious way.
I say yes.
New genre, yes.
All right. Thank you very much, professors, for all your contributions to this discussion. And I think we don't have any time left for any more questions. I would like to hand the floor back to Ian. Oh, sorry.